So this is, I promise I will be brief, but this is the dreaded word from your sponsor. My name is Stephen King, and I'm love to welcome you here on behalf of the Media Network, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you to this very timely event on the future prospects for Myanmar. We're delighted to be supporting this event at a time when the country is undergoing such a rapid transformation, an unprecedented transformation. And if I may, I wanted to just say a few words of explanation about who a Media Network is. For those of you who don't know us, we're a philanthropic investment foundation which was set up by Pierre Amidyar, who is the founder of eBay. So our approach to philanthropy is actually quite different from the normal traditional philanthropies. We're both a venture capital fund and we're also a philanthropic foundation. So that allows us to make equity investments in companies that will have a social impact and at the same time make grants across five initiative areas. And these are governance and citizen engagement, the ability for people to hold their government's accounts to account and to get more information about how governments are run. Given our eBay heritage, we're interested in the way in which technology can transform societies and which it can provide people with access to information and which it can also generate social change. We support initiatives in financial inclusion, from mobile money to microfinance and giving people access to funding. And we support educational systems in underdeveloped communities, and of particular relevance today in Myanmar, we also look for ways to help make it possible for people to secure and hold on to their land and their property rights as well. We've just started making grants in Myanmar over the last 3 years, and from the outset we've been astonished by the rapid adoption of technology in the country. This nascent tech sector that we're starting to see emerge in Yangon has huge opportunities not only to drive economic growth and create jobs, but also as other drivers of opportunity for transparency and accountability, for access to information, for education, and so on. And it's clear there's no baby steps in this technological transformation in Myanmar. It's gone from 0 to 100 miles an hour in about 3 years. I remember first visiting the country a couple of years ago when it cost $2,500 to buy a SIM card. And now you have 80% of the population who have access to smartphones, $23 smartphones from China. So this huge pent-up demand is something which we're very interested in encouraging, that entrepreneurial demand which we see every day in Yangon and throughout the country. That's why we've supported an entity called Pandia, which is a technology and innovation hub, which is in downtown Yangon and is a meeting place for technologists, for civil society organizations and others who want to look at ways in which technology can transform the country. But just in case I'm going to be accused of shiny-eyed Silicon Valley enthusiasm, I also want to say that we do support other activities as well. And that's part of the story of development in Myanmar. Obviously, there's education, there's land and property rights, there's financial inclusion, there's access to finance, which were equally important for us. And we work with organizations that provide people with information and tools that can engage with government, that can hold their government to account. Organizations like the Open Myanmar Initiative, which is tracking the activities and policies of the new parliamentarians. Organizations like the Yangon Journalism School, which is training independent investigative journalists throughout the country. And we were particularly pleased to support Global Witness last year with their groundbreaking Jade report, which looked at the way in which Jade is the source of much corruption in the country, and much of the resources from Jade are not going into the national budget. So it's clear that the road ahead for Myanmar will not be an easy one, and the incoming government is going to be weighed down by expectations for rapid change, which will be very difficult to deliver. Being able to analyse the future challenges for the government and bring the necessary intellectual rigour to this task is the work of experts such as we have here tonight on the panel. So before I hand over to Professor Justin Watkins, I'd like to thank SOAS for having organised such an impressive event, and we look forward to the debate. Thank you.
Right, well, thank you very much, Stephen. And the first thanks goes to you, who, put under pressure in one of your Burmese lessons, was asked whether there was something you'd be interested in funding. And I'm very pleased that the answer was yes. You weren't going to be allowed out of the room if you'd said no. But thanks also to Omidyar Network, Jim Peacock and Greg Pershall, who have been doing a lot of work behind the scenes. While I'm saying thank you, thanks in particular to Jane Savory and the Centres and Programmes Office here at SOAS. A lot of work has gone on behind the scenes, and to the technicians and the people operating the cameras around. Thank you very much. I should say, first of all, on that subject, that we are filming the event, and your presence here implies that you give us your permission to film you. If anyone doesn't want to be filmed, I'm afraid you have to leave. But I hope that's all right. So we, just to make that clear, I think it's going to be a podcast and it'll be available on the internet. So if you don't want your face to be seen, you know what you can do. And secondly, on the matter of technology, we've got a hashtag, Burma in the 21st century, and the hashtag is hashtag SOAS Myanmar. So if you are a tweeter, you're very welcome to use that hashtag, and who knows what might happen. I have no idea. But as Stephen said, tonight's discussion is going to be on the amazing changing situation in Myanmar following the elections last November. It's a pace of change which has been a very long time coming. As many of you will know, Burmese has been taught here at SOAS for 100 years. And there was a time, 15 or so, 10, even 10 years ago, where none of us thought that anything would change for the better. But here we are. It looks as if things may be changing in some ways. We'll find out. We'll try to examine which ways in particular shortly. So I'm going to say very little more about SOAS, except that we are struggling very hard to keep our expertise in Burmese alive and well at SOAS, and if I hope we have the support from everyone in the audience to support but the teaching of Burmese and the study of the country at SOAS to keep it going. And it's very wonderful to see that when we organise an event like this, it is so well attended. You're very welcome to stay afterwards. There's a reception upstairs in what's called the Brunei Suite. So please come and talk and share your thoughts about the evening's events. And the format of the evening is largely based on the BBC Question Time format. There are questions which are going to appear, questions which have been submitted by people who registered for the event, and we hope that in many cases you'll be here. You'll be invited to read your question when it appears on the screen. So if you can wait a second for the microphone to be handed to you and the camera to focus in on your face so that you can read your question, put it to the panel, and our chairman will then invite the panel members to address the question and give you their thoughts. So let me first of all introduce the panel. At the far end is Dr. Kim Amaji, who is the inaugural Dr. Aung San Suu Kyi Gender Research Fellow in International Gender Studies at Lady Margaret Hall in Oxford. She's also a research associate in anthropology. She's a social anthropologist, and she's the producer of an acclaimed documentary, Dreams of Dutiful Daughters, which was produced in 2013. And previously, for many years, she taught at the Australian National University, where we met when Burmese was being taught there for the very first time in 2003, which is where we met each other for the first time. So not in any particular order, Zunetta Herbert, in the center of the table there. Zunetta Herbert has been involved in human rights and development in Myanmar for more than 25 years. She lived in Mandalay during and after the 1988 pro-democracy uprising. She's advised governments and UN bodies, academics and international NGOs, and has written discussion papers for numerous international conferences. She's worked for Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, and was an interpreter for the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights prior to joining Partners Asia in 2008, which is where she now is a senior advisor. She has long and diverse experience and is also an alumna of SOAS. I'm pleased to note. Right, next we come to Dr. Lee Jones, so between Zunetta and Myanmar. Lee Jones is a senior lecturer in international politics at Queen Mary University of London and has written extensively on Myanmar, including in his books ASEAN, Sovereignty and Intervention in Southeast Asia, Societies Under Siege, Exploring How International Economic Sanctions Do Not Work, and co-authored Governing Borderless Threats, Non-Traditional Security, and the Politics of State Transformation. So there's some real political science book titles for you. Fantastic. And then last on our panel is Uso Intan, also known to the BBC's Burmese audiences by his broadcast name Mintet. He is the desk editor with the BBC Burmese service in London. Uso Intan joined the BBC in 2001 as a producer and became a desk editor in 2007. He's part of the dedicated team of journalists at BBC Burmese, whose reporting has won over the years numerous international awards, such as Wreath Awards and AIB Awards. He regularly appears on BBC TV and radio programs, making sense of the complex Myanmar politics to international audiences. He occasionally travels to Myanmar to report on the country's political developments, including all three recent elections. And we're very pleased to have someone from the BBC here. Their knowledge is unsurpassed. And finally, our chairman, my colleague, Dr. Michael Bueller, who is lecturer in comparative politics in the Department of Politics and International Studies here at SOAS. I'm delighted that he agreed to chair this evening's session. He's been teaching for 3 hours this afternoon and ran from the classroom to do another several hours of talking. So hopefully he will be good at diverting talk to our panelists, who are the people we want to hear from. So thank you very much.
All right, good evening and welcome. I'm actually going to say as little as possible because I just talked for the last 3 hours, as Justin pointed out. He also told me that my main job would actually be to tell people when it's time for the reception at 7:45. and this is exactly what I'm going to do. But in between then and now, I'm going to moderate this talk. Now, the way we thought we would organize this is that I would like every panelist to maybe say something about what they perceive as the main challenges Burma is facing over the next 12 to 24 months, probably. And after that, we'll have a look at the questions that you submitted by email. If we still have time, we probably also then open up the floor for some questions from the audience. But maybe we'll start with you. So what do you see as some of the most burning kind of issues that the government and the opposition also have to address?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me on the panel, and thank you for your interest coming here. This is an exciting time. This is it's a juncture, important juncture in Myanmar's history. Transition is taking place, and people have very, very high hopes and expectations. I traveled to Myanmar just before the elections and traveled across the country and met a lot of people. All of them unanimously said that they wanted to end that current system at the time. And they wanted change. Change is and has been the buzzword in the country until now. So they wanted change. That's why when the election came, they came out in large number and they voted in the government they wanted to see, and they voted out the government they wanted to end. That's why when the results are collated on the very evening of the election day, I was right in front of the NLD office, and we were interviewing NLD officials. The results were trickling in, and they all were surprised. They didn't expect the results to be that big a margin. So the margin was so big that even the NLD officials were quite surprised. Likewise, the ruling party, USDP, they were also in shell shock. They didn't expect the results to be that, you know, in disfavor of them. So they hoped that they would muster a few seats, you know, a number of seats in the parliament so that they could, combine with the help of the 25% seats occupied by the military MPs, they could at least form, you know, a good enough number to form a coalition government, which was not to be. So that was really kind of big surprise for all the Myanmar watchers. I was talking to my fellow colleagues, and then we had to admit that we were quite wrong in our predicting the results. But jubilation came with premonition. After the results were confirmed, then when we spoke to the people, they were a little bit felt anxious, because there was an incident, precedence in 1990 elections when NLD won in a very large landslide, but the results were not recognized. Results were ignored by the military. Military came and seized power. And so there was a sense of deja vu, and people were quite anxious. Even Aung San Suu Kyi herself, we interviewed her maybe just after the election victory, and she told the journalists to stay on because that was the time, important time, she said. Anything could happen, you know, right after the election. So we stay on for a week. Thankfully, nothing drastic happened. People's premonition was evident when they thought that, you know, the military wouldn't willingly hand over power to the winning party. So we, BBC, we have a weekly Have Your Say program. In one of the Have Your Say programs, we posed this question. Yes, transition is fine. Now the NLD has won the elections. They are going to take the power. But what about the transitional justice? What about the alleged atrocious crimes committed by the previous military regime? Should we forget them? So we posed that question. We received thousands of emails and letters asking us not to proceed with this topic because they thought their reason was that that could put military, that could frighten the military, and military could do something to take back their expectations. Their expectation would be dashed. So that was the kind of scenario that's happening. People were quite concerned whether the military would willingly hand over the power or not. But now the transition, the time has come. The transition is taking place, and in 2 days' time, the NLD will nominate their vice president and the election of the president, next president. So the title says that the Myanmar government taking shape. Yes, taking shape behind the scenes. We don't know who the NLD would nominate. We have some names, but nobody has been confirmed yet. NLD is, that's the one of the best closely guarded secrets in the NLD. NLD is quite tight-lipped, so we don't know who would be there. But there are tricky issues, like, you know, my other colleagues also will be talking about this constitutional issue. Constitution as it stands bars Aung San Suu Kyi from becoming the president. So in the past few weeks, Aung San Suu Kyi tried to kind of get an agreement with the military to change or suspend that constitutional clause. But we understand that the negotiation did not bear any fruit. That's why in the initial months, then we won't see Aung San Suu Kyi as the president. But she said if she cannot become the president, she would be above the president. We don't know how that shape will, because the constitution doesn't have any provision for that. But these are the issues, and the most important issue that NLD will have to do is the dealing with the military. And it depends on how successful Aung San Suu Kyi and the NLD can negotiate. Then the country future depends very much on that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Sunetta, do you share these views and assessment?
Yes, I think that's absolutely the case. But I also, if we're talking about the difficulties facing Myanmar rather than the NLD government, I think that it's important to also remember how we got here and how actually this is part of the change is really about a kind of normalization of a country that has always been rather extraordinary. And one of the things that I think is incredibly important in this movement is the role of civil society organizations, both in creating this moment, in the support of the National League for Democracy, but also in ensuring that come the next election in 2020, because we do now have a timetable for the next election, which in itself is somewhat miraculous, actually. People can plan their lives in a way that has never been possible in Myanmar, and for me that is very miraculous. But the civil society organizations that have supported the NLD, have brought the NLD to power, are very concerned about these very about the extent of, in a sense, the NLD victory, and there is a if Myanmar is going to remain on a positive trajectory as a democratic country, then civil society has to work extremely hard to create peace, because you can't leave it to a top-down process to create a sense of active citizens who are engaged in politics and want to hold their governments accountable, no matter who is in government. And this has to happen in the next few years, or it won't happen, is my view. And I think this is probably the biggest challenge for the country, is to make sure that the current euphoria, the current sort of inflow of aid and assistance to the government actually also continues to create change at the grassroots level. The challenges that the country face in terms of clearing up the mess that the military couldn't sort out, that Thein Sein's government couldn't sort out, particularly in terms of the ethnic nationalities and ethnic peace, particularly in terms of things like the Myitsone Dam, for example, are going to be very, very difficult. And the civil society needs to be seen as a friend of the government and needs to be working in their own way to continue to build networks that work beyond the current existing structures, which is basically a military complex. And I think also, and this is probably slightly off the point for some people, but I do think that one of the big challenges for Myanmar going forward is going to be natural disasters. And this is something that, you know, not enough is ever really talked about, but already it's March now. Already there are large swathes of the country don't have enough water. The monsoon won't come until, you know, May. I mean, the environment is changing in Myanmar probably faster than in many countries in the world, and part of it is because of, you know, deforestation, part of it is because of a rising population. There's many reasons for Myanmar's extreme vulnerability to natural disasters, and I suspect that this is going to be something that the government is going to have to face, and along with creating peace, I would say these are probably going to be two of the biggest challenges in the next 5 years.
Thank you. I just want to attack the title of the event. At the very least, there should be a question mark, shouldn't there? All change at the top. Because, of course, it's not all change at the top. And this is a fundamental issue. There are two very senior people at the very top who are not leaving their jobs, and they are the military commander-in-chief and his deputy. And this signals the elements of continuity from the Aung San regime. And I think we have to remember how we got here. I agree with Zunetra on that. How did we get to this pass? Because of a military-led transition from military rule. So the NLD has come to power, yes, but within a constitutional system, within a political and economic system designed by and for the military. And so that creates very serious constraints on the government. And some of those constraints are constitutional, and some of them are more structural and informal. The constitutional constraints, we've already heard about the issue about the presidency, there will be principal agent problems, to use a political science term, because I am a political scientist, sorry about that, Justin. She will have to try and control her proxy from afar. We don't know who that's going to be yet. That will not necessarily be easy because the executive is deliberately insulated from popular and legislative control and accountability. The military continues to dominate key state agencies. It is the commander-in-chief that commands the army, not the president. And he has sole control over all military affairs and sole command over all the coercive apparatuses of the state, including the police. The commander-in-chief appoints
the ministers of Home Affairs, Defence and Border Affairs. That gives the military control over vast swathes of public policy, some of the most important, particularly as regards the peace process and relations with Myanmar's ethnic minorities. The CNC also appoints 5 of the 11 members of the National Defence and Security Council, which kind of floats above and superintends the business of government. So the army is still Myanmar's most coherent, powerful institution. The state is extremely weak and ramshackle in terms of its civilian wing. Any attempts to cut the military's budget will be severely resisted on grounds of security and sovereignty, and the military can source a lot of its income off budget anyway. 80% of senior civil servants in the country are former military officials. And of course, the military controls 25% of parliamentary seats, which gives it a de facto veto over any constitutional change, and thereby over really serious political reform, including a meaningful settlement with the ethnic minority ceasefire groups. And then there are a range of non-constitutional, non-institutional constraints on the government. The political complexes in Myanmar's borderlands, the realities in those areas, it's not the state that rules, it is potentially quite fragile pacts between local military officials, local civilian officials, and ceasefire elites. And they are often fragile, there is still fighting in many areas, and there is a risk from the ethnic minority perspective of the return of what under British colonialism was called diarchy, where you had the state basically controlling the center, and we may see liberalization to some extent in the Bamar-dominated central areas of Myanmar, and continued authoritarian rule in the borderlands through local elites. Corruption, of course, remains endemic. Aung San Suu Kyi has this mantra of the rule of law. Rule of law is not a magic wand. It is also very difficult to bring about in a country where 70% of the judges are estimated to take bribes. Communal tensions remain very deep and very severe. Islamophobia has not gone away. The Mabata, the right-wing nationalist, anti-Muslim, extremist Buddhist monks, they are still around, and they are they've already thrown down the gauntlet to the new government. And this is a really serious issue. The continued economic dominance of crony capitalists, who were essentially brought into being by the previous military regime, there is no way that they can be simply expropriated. Their capital, their expertise is going to be needed, and that will constrain the amount of economic reform that can be brought in. And finally, the NLD itself is a weak party. It's still very little more than a personal vehicle for Aung San Suu Kyi. And I think she realizes that a great deal of reform and party building is going to be necessary over the next 5 years. It does have an authoritarian cast. I think its relationship with civil society is often a very tenuous one, where anybody that tries to play a role that may seem to infringe on NLD territory is given short shrift by some of the rather ancient individuals who dominate the party. So, as has already been said, there are huge expectations on the new government, but there are very severe constraints on what it will be able to achieve in practice.
So you've mentioned many issues that we'll come back to when we look at the questions that people have submitted, but if you could maybe just tell us quickly what you think are the priorities for the government and the challenges.
I know time is here, but I cannot let the opportunity pass without my tribute to the special role of SOAS in Burmese studies. SOAS has long committed Burmese studies by 2 most talented Burmese language teachers that influence on the world. And I think it's like, you know, SOAS realized how lucky they are, you know, to have such excellent teachers and to keep Burmese studies here alive. And today is also International Women's Day. So like, kind of, it is really for me that like, you know, really appropriate to talk about women issue that matter most in the story, in Burma. So if things are normal, I would today say that like, today, the first time International Women's Day is held in Burma under the newly elected democratic government and the president of Aung San Suu Kyi. But things are not so simple and straightforward in Burma. So, and we all know that, like, you know, she is still facing for her struggle to be a president. And we also know that and how military resub themselves with 25% of seat, both upper and lower house, and the presidency for those with a military vision. And despite all that, the Aung San Suu Kyi managed to bring many educated and passionate academic and activists to the parliament. This is the first time ever in the history of Burmese parliament women were, many female MPs were in the parliament. And in Burma, there were 51.4 million people. Women comprised more than half, accounting 26.5. So more than 1.7 million than men. In this election, 800 out of 6,074 elected parliamentarians are women, making up 13%. So the number of female representatives increased in general. Sadly, the NLD itself reduced the female representative in their party from their own accord of 30% in 2015 to now 13%. But anyways, Burma managed to lift themselves above the position of being the least female representative number in the region. Still, 87% of Burmese parliamentarians are overwhelmingly men and dominated the parliament. So, NLD also did not put forward a greater number of female candidates, which could have significantly lift and boost female representation in the parliament. There are many barriers and challenges in political representation. And I want to one focus on how prolonged militarization influence and create militarized culture that we have hardly talked about it. And as Cynthia and Lou said it, to become militarized is to adopt militaristic values. So, and military ideologies are accepted as a normal and way of life. So this lead to particular form of cultural change. So actually, like, you know, in Burma, what kind of struggle and barriers that women face? Structural nature of, and number one is like cultural religion. One of the most important factor of justification of male dominance and male superiority over women is porn. Porn is fundamental difference between men and women. Men are considered being born with porn on their right shoulders. Women are considered as spiritually lower because they are born without it. So in other words, men alone can have porn. Men alone become pongi monks and are naturally secure one of the two most powerful and highest social orders within the male domains in monastic education, monastic institution. The concept justifies and accepts superiority of male roles in leading roles, such as in politics, such as in peace talk. This is the precisely reason that, like, kind of, you know, women are so hard to compete with the male-dominated area. But also, prolonged militarization also legitimizes their males' dominated role. For example, this is the exact reasons that 2008 Constitution, which guarantee equal opportunities of women as decorative. And because the Constitution referred that the position that are suitable for men only, and also the presidents must have military vision. And so that another religious order that we have talked about, Mabata. It is like a kind of, this is a Mabata, the organization, extreme nationalist religious authority that hijacked a rape of a Rakhine women and Rakhine state and succeeded in and to pass the Myanmar women's special marriage law. So this law will impact on women in everyday life. For example, the new population control bill, which criminalized women for having children less than 3 years apart. While under this current penal code, marital rape is legal in Burma, unless the wife is 14 years old or younger. This means that the wife has little or no control over her own body, her or her husband's sexual drive. The husband can use violence legitimately if she do not comply. Pregnancy may not be her choice, but they are solely responsible for their reproductive health. Abortion is criminalized. In such environment, women may desperately seek unlawful or unsafe abortion. And similarly, like I know, it's really interesting that in education sector so far. But what happened with women in the education sector where they dominated the position? If we look at the trend of the women outnumber in education.
Maybe we'll come back to some of these issues.
This is how many female rectors, in Burma, zero until last year.
I think you've raised many important points, but maybe we'll come back to them throughout the evening, right? I would try to give the audience a chance to actually answer or pose a few questions, right? And we'll come back to a lot of the points that you've mentioned. So we've received a lot of submissions and questions, and I've tried to come up with a selection that is representative of the submissions we've received. And I would like to start with questions that pertain to the broader kind of political challenges that Burma is facing. And so we have received a question from Nola Werwag from Amnesty International UK. I don't know if you're here. No. So she basically was interested in, Lee mentioned this already, and Sunetta also, that basically there is a need now for the normalization of politics in Burma, but the question, of course, is to what extent that is actually possible, given the residual powers that the military actually has. And so the question that she asked is, how much potential for change is there for the new government if the military holds a quarter of seats and important ministries? The second kind of related question that she submitted, and many other people had an interest in as well, is that Aung San Suu Kyi also seems to have a bit of an authoritarian streak. She basically said that she will rule above the president or be above the president. And so the question that Nola asked here is also, is this actually true? Is she quite authoritarian? And if so, how will it actually affect the new government? Maybe Sunetta, you could start, probably about 2 minutes or so, and then we'll go over to Lee.
On the first part, as Lee has said, it is very important that the military still have 25% of the seats, and they will do for a long time. And it will very much constrain what the NLD government can do. However, there are, particularly in the area of the rule of law, in fact, there are some areas, like, for example, the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court currently has 7 members, 4 of whom are military judges, 3 of whom are civilian, but it can actually have 10 members under the Constitution. So it'd be very easy for the NLD to appoint some new members of the Supreme Court who could be actually experienced lawyers, which would make a change. And they actually have quite a lot of power as the Supreme Court, and they could start or restart a common law system in Myanmar and actually publishing the reports of records of judicial hearings to actually interpret the law as it is supposed to be interpreted. I mean, one of the big reasons why the legal system is so corrupt is because of the very deliberate misuse of existing criminal procedure codes. And this doesn't require new laws. It doesn't require the time that it's going to take to do that. That's one small example. So there is quite a lot that can be done, even with the 25%. I mean, nobody thought that the Thein Sein government would go as far as they went, let's face it. I mean, you know, we all expected that would be a military-controlled government that wasn't going to make any changes. They did. The military are aware of their new interests and have different ways of being. They've got all of the military MPs are actually extremely well-educated, very smart, very clever guys, but you know they are willing to compromise. It's been shown. The question is how far will the NLD be able to push them on things that really matter to a long-term democratic development of the country? And as for Aung San Suu Kyi's authoritarianism, well, I personally am not going to comment on that, but there is certainly, an anxiety among civil society, for example, that the NLD, or rather Aung San Suu Kyi, will try to capture civil society space by insisting that foreign donors only work through certain organizations, by the creation of more gongos. The Dorkinji Foundation will inevitably, and I'm sure this is going to happen, play a much bigger role in the country. We will see the Dorkinji Foundation becoming the donor of the NGO gongo of choice, effectively. And that is a concern. But at the same time, you know, look at the makeup of the MPs. I mean, 13 of the MPs that were elected were part of the EITI, the Extractive Industries Alliance. So they've been trained, they know about extractive industries, all of their friends are from CSOs. Over 70 of the MPs are former political prisoners who, since their release, have worked with CSOs, have fought for rights. I mean, these are not people that are going to sit back and say, oh, sorry, ma'am, you know, they may to begin with, and there will be a honeymoon period where we'll wait and see, and the CSOs externally from the NLD are also going to, I'm sure, allow for the NLD to make their move, see how far they go, but it's not going to be possible for one person to run a country. It's a big country.
Now, Lee, you've been a lot more pessimistic. Now, do you have something to say with regard to the residual powers? If we look at other transitions in Southeast Asia, very often after a few years, the military has actually been willing to give these residual powers up. Now, how do you see the situation in Burma?
So I think the way to understand the way that things will play out is to understand that what the military regime was doing for 20 years was to try and design a constitutional system which is the one we've got now. And they tried to impose it once in the 90s, it didn't work, and then they imposed it in 2010, and it did work. And so what you essentially have is a system where the military holds the ring, and there are certain red lines. Now, there is space within those red lines for the government to have considerable amount of autonomy, and I think the fact that the NLD was able to win so big and the military didn't step in shows that they have some considerable faith in this constitutional settlement that civilians won't muck it up, which is the way that the military is constantly looks at the civilians, that they are a threat to the stability and territorial integrity of the country. So the key thing for them are those things, well, they're understood as the national causes: sovereignty, territorial integrity. So relations with the ethnic minorities are a crucial area for the military, and there's going to be limited wiggle room. But in other areas, for example, economic and social policy, there could be space for considerably more policy autonomy. So that's the way to think about it, I think, is that different areas have got more or less wiggle room depending on where the military have drawn these lines. As for Aung San Suu Kyi, authoritarian is not the word I would use. Patrician, maybe, would be more accurate. I mean, I do think it's problematic when who is actually going to be president of the country is some kind of state secret, that there's no democratic participation in discussing that whatsoever. And just today, the number of people who were able to speak on behalf of the NLD was increased by 100%.
We've got two now.
Because there are now two. There's her and there's one other person. I mean, that's highly problematic if we think that the purpose of a party is to aggregate interests and to be a space for democratic development. I think she's by no means a stupid woman. She understands that she needs to develop the party, and she, I think, will appoint certain individuals to take that forward. She knows that she will have to delegate both in state matters and in party matters. If she doesn't, then the system will simply grind to a halt. And you'll get the same as we've always had in Myanmar, where people are afraid at local level of using their autonomy, taking decisions, being held accountable. All the decisions get funneled upwards. And so there's just a few people at the top taking decisions, and the whole system grinds to a halt. That is possible because there are years and years where that is exactly what people do to avoid having to take any responsibility and get caught making any, you know, errors. So that's something she's going to have to fight against. Her own instincts, maybe, which is to centralise, and the instincts of everybody else. I think it will be a tough road, actually.
Mm. What do you make of the quote that she said, she'll be above the president?
I think it's, even though it is like a kind of illogical, and yet she is the one who will make a difference, who would change. So like, you know, she would be doing that. But international community, they go to Burma, they want to see her. They want to talk to with her, not the other person. But another problem is that, like, we are talking about Aung San Suu Kyi being authoritarian, and we forgot about lack of critical skills that people have, and she has to work with them. So like a kind of, in first step, that like, you know, she is actually, yes, she is doing her own vision very closely, and she will not make any concession for anyone. So maybe she is ruling the party like dictatorship style. But at the same time, we can see for the first time that she become very strategic politicians and transform from starving activist to become, you know, like a strategic politician, how she actually shuffle the whole party, newly elected party members, number one, is very impressive, like, you know, bringing ethnic party and USDP and putting on together. Second one is like, she is really focusing on empowerment of party members. Now today, like SBS speaking in Burma, her party's members are sitting English exam, and they will be studying English accordingly. So there's like, you know, a lot of empowerment plans are at the moment, and she is working on her party's members. So I think only some point she will be controlling as a dictatorship style, and I think it's like, you know, she will change her leadership style and very soon.
Okay, thank you. Now, what do you make of the residual powers that the military has? And as Lee pointed out, basically they have set up a constitution that they've been working on for the last 25 plus years, and that give them enormous powers. Do you think there's any room for meaningful change in Burma?
When you say meaningful change, then people talk about the
towards
taking away of like, you know, 25%. That's untouchable. The red line for the military at the moment. That's why I agree with Lee that because, you know, they didn't disrupt this transition process, because military to some degree has confidence that until and unless that constitution, current 2008 constitution, is there, they have a certain kind of dominance in the country's politics. 25% they put it in, and the argument from the military side, when we ask them, why do you think you need to have that 25% members in the parliament, is that because we didn't want to stage another coup. We want to have some say, because so that, you know, when the MP, they have, military has a very kind of entrenched or intrinsic mistrust of the politician. So they don't want to let go of that. They don't want to see the parliament occupied only by the democratically elected MPs. So they put the 25% member in the parliament. So when the key decisions are made, then they will have their own say. They don't want to let go of that their say in that parliament. But in the previous parliament sessions, then, we found the military MPs, they did not always kind of object to some of the proposals made by the NLD or other, like, you know, ruling party, but what they are still kind of keeping to themselves is that when there are key decisions like changing of the constitution, the changing of the qualifications for the president and stuff, that could not get passed without their approval. They want to have that say. But more importantly, that, like Lee mentioned, that this is in the parliament, but outside of the parliament, the CNC, Commander-in-Chief, controls three key ministries. Most important thing is the Home Ministry. Home Ministry controls the police. And more importantly, Home Ministry controls the General Administration Department. You know, up to the township level, all the officiating, the officers who are managing administrative affairs are the military-appointed person. So they have set it up, the system. That's why they kind of, you know, people were quite surprised that why did the military let go of, you know, in 2010 elections, then let go of their power easily? Because they already set up the system. The constitution guarantees their continued dominance in the country's politics. So as long as the constitution is there, they're fine, they think.
Okay. Thank you. Now, what we haven't really talked about yet is maybe what leverage the international community has in terms of pushing for change in Myanmar. And so, which brings us to the second question, which Nick has submitted. Are you here? Yeah. So I was advised, so there's a microphone, the camera is moving in your direction, so we're, we're ready.
What does the panel think will help push the military into meaningful constitutional reform, both from within Burma and outside, given that the outside world has pretty much given away all of their bargaining chips in the naive or cynical anticipation of future reform?
Okay, so the assumption is that sanctions have made it or made a difference, right? So now that this is no longer there or as pronounced as it used to be, do we actually see now an international community that is unable to react if we see change unfold in ways that they did not expect? Maybe we'll start with you.
I think it's one of the things is that empowerment to the military, because like this is the time that like more than ever to work with the military, and Aung San Suu Kyi has been working so hard to negotiate with the military. Not only that, we must also remember that the military also being confined with their own institution and their own way of knowledge transferring. So like, it's really important that military also empower and learn what kind of professional military that they want to establish. And in recent weeks, we can see in the parliament that one of the things is that NLD is inviting overseas experts and to training them and including the military. I think this is a good thing. Another thing that is outside international communities, we need to work with the military. So we need to make sure that they are proudly departing from the politics. They have to be proudly departing because they have so many cards, and they have been also their professional ego has been hurt. So we need to make sure them working together with the military more than ever, and to make them understand professionalism in military, and also depart from their politics. In their own base.
Now, Lee, you're an IR scholar. Have sanctions made a difference? And now that this is no longer there, do we now see maybe change?
Yes, sanctions did make a difference in Myanmar. They delayed the country's democratization. And I mean that sincerely. My view is that they're entirely counterproductive, and they prolonged a stalemate between the two sides and actually made it harder for the military to impose their constitution, because they did create difficulties for the regime. There's no doubt about that. But the reason why we've got to this situation is because of a military-led process. They were not forced from power. They are proudly retreating from power, thinking that they've been successful. Now, from that perspective, there is nothing that the outside world can do to force them into meaningful constitutional change. They labored for 25 years, and they were perfectly willing to accept all of the costs attendant on that. For themselves, for their people, they didn't like it, but they endured it. And they've been fighting for many more decades to keep the country together. And from their perspective, this is their role, this is their function. They are the saviors of the nation, the guardians of the nation state and the country's territorial integrity. The constitutional settlement is required from their perspective to safeguard the national goals, to safeguard the country's territorial integrity, because civilian governments cannot be trusted to do it for now. In the long term, I think the military will gradually step back from the political arena, but we're talking long term here. They won't do it until they're satisfied that a civilian government can govern in a way that the military thinks a civilian government should govern. The outside world never had any bargaining chips, really, but what few it had, it threw away with sanctions. It doesn't really have any now. I think what the outside world needs to do is to take a lead from the democratically elected government of Myanmar, which needs to take a very strategic approach to the reform of the state to try to maximize space within these red lines. And donors need to be coordinated by the democratically elected government in support of key reform agendas. Some of them could be the ones that Mars just mentioned. There may well be others in terms of better training for the police, training for the military, things like this, but these will be relatively marginal things. Essentially, this is a domestically driven process.
Now, many people also had questions about the situation with regard to ethnic minorities in Burma. So we had lots and lots of submissions with regard to that issue. Now, the next question is from Rasmus Scheut, who is a consultant at Development Pathways, an NGO here in London. Are you here? No? So he basically was interested in the opinion of the panelists with regard to the prospects of a genuine national ceasefire agreement, I assume, with ethnic minority groups happening in the near future. Is there a potential there for ceasefire agreements with the major kind of ethnic minority groups?
Okay. Yeah, the previous government, before they went out, then they tried very hard to reach this nationwide ceasefire agreement because they wanted to lay down as their legacy that they made peace with all ethnic ceasefire groups, but which was not to be, and only they managed to make peace agreements with eight groups, and most of them are smaller, you know, non-fighting groups.
It was called the National Ceasefire Agreement.
That's why even
just eight groups.
Yeah, that's right. Why people are saying that it should not be called the nationwide ceasefire agreement. It's only partial.
Right.
But some remaining groups, they wanted to wait. Because, you know, what happened was that the previous government, although they went out to the offer peace agreement with the ethnic, then it's obvious, it's quite evident that even the president would then say, ask the military to stop, you know, fighting or offensive against some ethnic groups, then military acted in their own ways. So, yeah, they went out and then they were kind of having wars, fighting with the group. So the ethnic groups were quite reluctant. They didn't have much faith in the previous government, whether they could really reach agreement. Because in the past, what the previous government's idea was just lay down your arms first, then we can talk. So the ethnic groups, then they couldn't kind of, they could not embrace that idea. That's why there was some mistrust ongoing. But all the remaining ethnic groups wanted to wait until the NLD government come to power, and they were started to make deal. Aung San Suu Kyi also, the NLD, the incoming government, set its top priority, the reconciliation, national reconciliation with the ethnic groups. So when it comes to power, there is a more kind of the positive feeling from the ethnic group side, and then that could be much more possible. Aung San Suu Kyi also, we heard that, you know, her role, what will be her role in the coming government, we don't know yet, but what we knew is that she already appointed herself. That's not publicized yet, but we heard from a very inside source that she appointed herself as the chief negotiator. She herself will handle this negotiation deals with the ethnic group. So that, you know, in her government time, then, because there could be the trust, which was a very short currency with the previous government, and there is a much more likely that the ceasefire and peace will happen in the NLD government's time.
Sunita?
I think that the question is wrong, actually. Because it's not a ceasefire agreement that's needed in Myanmar. It never has been. I mean, the Kachin had a ceasefire agreement that was successful. There was no fighting. For 17 years, they had a ceasefire agreement, and there was no discussion about a political settlement during that time. The peace talks that have gone on under the U Thein Sein government have been really about the process for a ceasefire agreement that might end up with some kind of process that might somewhere down the line have a political discussion. And there is what is needed is a political settlement, not a ceasefire. And I think this is going to be enormously challenging for any government, constrained as they are by the presence of the army, for whom this is their territory. There are still 50,000 internally displaced people in Kachin State since the fighting broke out again in 2011. Now, today, this week, there is increased fighting in Shan State between people who signed the NCA and people who didn't sign the NCA. I mean, this is going to be a really, really major problem. Whether, you know, who can be trusted now sure. to be the peace brokers. And frankly, the donors have a big role to play in this. They had a big role not fulfilling their objective of do no harm in the way that they funded the priest process with, I think there are now 6 different donor coordination mechanisms. Surely that means one. I mean, why do you have 6 donor coordination mechanisms for the peace process? It is a little bit absurd. But for sure, a genuine political process by which a federal structure, and it is in the NLD manifesto that they will work towards a constitutional federalism when they want to change the constitution. But at the moment, all they're talking about in terms of changing the constitution is to have Aung San Suu Kyi as president. This is a problem. But I think all we can say is that I would hope that that would happen, and I fear that it won't.
Just one point, can I add?
Absolutely.
The military, people believe that military doesn't really want peace with the ethnic groups because having so many ethnic armies fighting, then they can justify their expansion, they can justify their important role in the country. That's why they don't genuinely want peace with the government. That's the commonly held belief in the country.
Lee?
I perhaps a bit more upbeat in the sense that I think there have been moments during the last 5 years where I think a breakthrough was almost on the horizon and then things went wrong. I think that the military have got, this is the way they botched the transition, trying to force the ethnic minority ceasefire groups to become border guard forces under the army's command. The ethnic minorities had signed up to the constitution. Many of the people who had boycotted the National Convention in the 1990s were campaigning for it. The same document, essentially, no changes, which showed that they were actually weakened relative to the military over the course of 20 years. Mm. So they're in a weakened position. They're willing to accept the border guard force proposal. The issue was the timing. Would it be before or after the elections? And the military overplayed their hand. So the military know that this is one area of the transition that they got wrong. And they, I think, have accepted the need for something else. But what that something else is not quite clear. I mean, the fact that the word federalism is on the agenda, I think, is an enormous step forward. True. This is a taboo word, the F word, in the Myanmar context. Mm-hmm. We're now seriously talking about some kind of power sharing, devolution, resource sharing settlement. The contours of that have to be hammered out, and it will be very difficult. Mm. But I think there are smart people in the military who understand this has to happen, and the difficulty is getting all the big players in the same room, because this has been a big issue, and establishing trust between the main parties in the sequencing of things like the disarmament of groups or their merging into the military. These are the things that have to be worked out. I would hope that we would see within this parliament, we will see movements towards a genuine political settlement and constitutional changes to enshrine that. I think there is some space for optimism, but it's a very, very difficult road. And the fact that she feels the need to lead the process tells you how fraught it's going to be, and what authority does she have to control the military? This is the difficulty. It's all about, can you get a pacted transition where everybody's on board and you can really trust those commitments in a fragmented constitutional system? Excuse me. That's a real real difficulty.
But I don't see the Damador being willing to give up the... I mean, even at the Union Peace Conference in January, you know, when they brought all those hundreds of delegates together to talk about it, the military's main demand was a single army. That was their number one demand. And they want that before you can have any political solution.
Yeah, this is the sequence. This is the sequencing issue. Yeah, at what point do the ethnic minority ceasefire militias become part of border guard forces under essentially army command? Yeah. You know, there's a reason why the ceasefire groups will not move to
to do that until there's political settlement. It has to be as part of an overall settlement, which is why I agree with you that the issue is not about ceasefires. The issue is about negotiating a settlement that is stepwise and has binding commitments on a strict timetable. Mm. I do think that there are forces for compromise, but it's going to be very difficult. And there does need to be compromise, I think, on both sides. Yeah. The infighting among the ethnic minorities is a serious problem. The way that they're too willing sometimes to be used as divide and rule pawns by the military and play that old game. So there are, but I think, as you say, there are educated people who are open-minded, even in Parliament, to making some kinds of changes. It's not going to be easy, but I hope there is some space for optimism.
Madi?
I think it's the problem is that many ceasefire groups complain that after they signed ceasefire, their lands have been grabbed under the name of development. And there's one biggest issue that they lost their trust even more. And also another one is this is not just about ethnic fighting or ceasefire, but it is actually resource-based territory control and power. So actually the military, Burmese military directly involving this issue together with crony. And some of you might already saw Global Witness, including General Thanh Shwe has been involved in Kachin State. So this is the direct involvement of the military in resource business. That is a problem, and military were not willing to negotiate unless their interests are secure.
Many people also wondered about another ethnic minority or a religious minority. Lee and Zoe also before mentioned Islamophobia, and so a couple of questions came in with regard to the situation of the Rohingya. Now, Isabel Jacques had a question with regard to Rakhine State. Are you here? Yeah? All right. And I suggest we then also have a question combined with this by Sally MacDonald, who also wondered about the Rohingya. But maybe you could last.
My question then was, what expectations are there that the new government will address the long-standing problems in Rakhine State of centre-periphery tensions, inter-communal and inter-religious conflict with minority Muslim communities, and extreme poverty and underdevelopment? And how might the new government do so? So it's a big question.
Okay, and Sally asked, what practical steps would each of the panelists take towards lessening the problems of the Rohingya? So if you maybe have solutions in terms of how the government could move forward with regard to that issue, and then also what Isabel just addressed, how do we deal with this?
And it's really interesting, and I've been working in Rakhine State, and particularly working with both Rohingya and Rakhine women. And it is often when we talk about Rohingya, we don't necessarily talk about Rakhine. Because if we talk about Rohingya and Buddhist nationalists, right? Both Rakhine and Rohingyas live same similar population in Rakhine State. When actually talk about this, they talk about Rohingya only. So when I met with a lot of Rakhine, and they feel like there's nobody interested in Rakhine State, Rakhine people. What Rakhine people suffer. They talk about only Rohingya. So this is the reason that Rakhine is the only ethnic body actually won the election. So they feel that only Rakhine people can protect Rakhine. But second point is that I like to emphasize is, in terms of Burmese concept, Rakhines are considered most distrust people. So there is a proverb saying that if you see a Rakhine and a poisonous snake, you kill Rakhine. So there's Rakhine feel that they are the lowest of the low in Burmese ethnic rank. And yet, they feel international community as well as a community targeted them. So that is that created a lot of problem, and I see many young tourist guide becoming soldiers to they feel they need to defend. So we need to watch out. We don't want to encourage them more growing tension inside their community. But also really the really sad thing is that they when I actually work with them, they told me many stories that they were together before without any problem. So up to 2012. So like they were saying that, like, you know, we went to the school together, we, you know, like, you know, so actually there is something there. Like, you know, so the community, the valued. And another point is that, and basically also we need to listen to the community. Community of both sides, not just one. Then we can make a policy. And one of the most fundamental issue of this Rakhine Rohingya issue is that we need a thorough research based on history and anthropology. And looking and interviewing the people who live there and going back to the history, how did it happen? But also, and we need to look at 1982 citizenship law, which is like, you know, far too restrict. So like a kind of, this law need to be changing. But also there's like a kind of, we need to go beyond the name of Rohingya or not, but we need to go beyond that, like a kind of, these people who live there is like, you know, both sides are saying that there are Rohingya people living there for a century. But also there are newcomers that are being bribed to the former government and coming to Burma to go to third world country to become refugee. So like, you know, these issues, we need to do research thoroughly rather than like, you know, we are speculating.
Sunetta, you were shaking your head.
Ah. I didn't think you'd see that. I really appreciate the question, and particularly the way that you put it, actually, Isabel, because as Dr. Ma has said, that, you know, Rakhine State, I mean, I've been thinking about it in the last few days, actually, is the Rakhine State is the Turkey of Europe, right? and in fact, you know, Rakhine State, there is not a single new road that has been built in Rakhine State since about 92. You know, there is not a bridge. There has been no development in that part of Myanmar. And it could be an extremely wealthy part of the country. There was, for a very short period, between 95 and 97, I think, before the Asian collapse, there was some significant investment in the area from Southeast Asian companies that were doing prawn farms and fisheries and so on. That dried up after the Asia collapse. But, I mean, you know, Rakhine friends, Rakhine people that I know have been, for years, been prevented from getting the licenses they need to buy the new engine for their boat so that they can work more effectively. I mean, for years, everything has been, the lid has been very tightly held on Rakhine State that it would have no development. And as a result, it ends up in a blow up in ethnic tension. And as for the Rohingya, I mean, the Rohingya, there are still, since 1992, refugee camps in Bangladesh of Rohingya refugees that fled in 92. They are still there. It is not just a Burmese problem. And I think probably the only way that it can be addressed and can be solved is by talking about it as not just a Burmese problem. Because the camps in Myanmar are actually a hell of a lot better than the camps that they've been living in Bangladesh, but they are still awful. And it's not tenable just to leave it as it is. It's not tenable to actually, I don't think, to go back to history and try and justify their presence. That isn't the point. The point is now, the present. How are we going to live together? They have been, Rakhine businesses have been incredibly reliant on cheap Rohingya labor. I mean, you everywhere in Rakhine State, it was the Rohingya that did all the dirty jobs. You know, they're needed. There just needs to be some settlement there. But the Rakhine need to be respected by the Burmans I mean, it is no coincidence that Rakhine State was the last state that became part of the what was then Myanmar before Burma, before the British occupied in, you know, it was the first state that the British took. So, you know, it is no coincidence. It's never been a very happy part of Burma. The NLD government, I think, is going to have to find some way of working with the Rakhine National League for Democracy, and they're going to have to do serious development work there that has never taken place before. And I think through that and through talking with it as a regional issue, I mean, you know, Bangladesh is an extremely low-lying country. There is global warming. There are masses of migration happening from Bangladesh all over the place. And that is not to deny the Rohingyas that, you know, have been living in Myanmar forever, but there are many that Bangladeshis are leaving to go everywhere, and it's going to be a continuing problem in the region. So I think, you know, there's an opportunity to internationalize it. There's also an opportunity to, as Turkey is demanding from Europe now, you know, to give them the development, the financial assistance they need to improve the lot of all the people in Rakhine State, including the Rohingya.
Since you mentioned development, it's probably a good time to talk about the economic challenges that Burma is facing. And you mentioned the lack of roads in that part of Burma. Now, the government has made huge promises in terms of infrastructure development. And so Joshua had a question about who is actually going to pay for this and how will they pay for it. Are you here, Joshua? Yeah, all right, over there.
I was just curious what the panel's view is in terms of sort of, you know, there's committed increase in public spending in education, healthcare. Where is the money coming from? As we know, the reality is that there are not many companies who are paying sort of, you know, increase a huge amount of taxes in Burma, and also the revenue collection is very poor as well. Can I just make it very clear, there's nothing to do with my personal tax planning.
Now, I don't know what the revenue collection percentage is in Burma, how many people actually do pay taxes, but it's usually very, very low, below 10%
yeah.
Probably. Now, how do you see this issue?
I ask you, NLD, they did not come out, apart from their election manifesto, they didn't come out with the concrete plans, but they are in the back of... behind the scenes, they've been kind of talking, planning for the short term and long term. Because, and I knew that NLD Economics Committee met on Saturday with Aung San Suu Kyi, and then one member told us that they have planned for the 100-day plan. So their main agenda is to alleviate poverty and create jobs. They wanted to be seen in the first 100 days that they are the party for the people and to kind of help the people, and they are. The revenue policies, and I asked them, one of the members, and then they just sent me the email just before I came into this room, and the NLD's economic policies will be based on three pillars. He said, number one is the fiscal prudence, which covers the taxation, and they NLD understands that there are, like, you know, there's a huge problem for the government. There are so many people who avoid taxes, and also the cronies, they pay very little tax. One crony I remember, that's, I shouldn't quote him because it's the off the record, he told me that one of the top cronies in Myanmar, then in one of our my conversation with him, he said he was accused of supporting the government. He said, no, I wasn't supporting the government because, you know, I paid tax, I paid very low tax. He let it out because he said that I was paying, you know, he earned his income in US dollars, but he was paying back to the government on the official term that time is 6 charts per dollar, you know. So then that kind of thing. And physical, the three pillars the NLD will be, NLD's economic policies is fiscal prudence, reform of government, and revitalization of agriculture. So under the fiscal prudence, they are planning to have a range of different taxes. They didn't explain whether that will be raising the tax, but they said they understand the problem of tax avoidance. So they will have a very new range of taxes to adjust the marginal rates of taxation, introduce new kinds of tax to increase tax base.
Lee?
How has the government been financing rising expenditure? A lot of it's through borrowing, the continued monetization of government debt. So the central bank's supposed to not do this, but essentially prints money, lends to the government.
And this is serious. Some people are talking about an IMF intervention to correct a persistent deficit issue. Export revenues are going to continue to be absolutely crucial to the state. There's no way that the NLD government is going to be able to revitalize agriculture in 100 days or 100 years. That is not going to become the fiscal basis of the state. It just won't. Agriculture produces about 25% of GDP, employs 70% of the people, but only 25% of GDP. You know, so gas exports, that's $2 billion a year. So this is going to continue to be crucial, and this is a very severe dilemma for the government. Export revenues are vital to the state's integrity. But on the other hand, if you're exporting all of your gas and hydropower, how do you provide the electricity that's required for raising standards of living and for fueling factories and development? It's a difficult trade-off, and that's one that's going to have to be confronted. And of course, the resource export issues are tied up with all these kind of extractive investments and compacts in the borderlands, and are very thorny issues. There is massive scope for improvement in revenue collection. Bob Taylor gives some figures in his work, and I think one figure that comes to my mind is something like 5%, something like that. Yeah. About 5% of the state's income comes from ordinary taxation revenue. Mm. So it's very poor, and it shows the sheer weakness of Myanmar state structures apart from the military. So there is massive scope for change just in terms of collecting the existing taxations without really creating new taxes. But the main area where you could really ramp up enforcement and really make a lot of hard cash is on the borders. Because a lot of border trade is highly irregular. And the military government and the previous administration tried to reroute a lot of trade away from the borders and through the port at Yangon, with some considerable success. But as we know from, say, the Global Witness Report on jade, a lot of jade is going across the Chinese border, a lot more than we ever realized if we are to trust that report. $7 billion worth a year? I mean, there is clearly scope for the people to be getting a share of the people's natural resources. At the moment, it's going to benefit a very narrow clique of individuals, but they are a very powerful clique of individuals. And so taxation is not a neutral technical issue. It's a political matter. It will be something fought over and struggled over, just like everything else in the next 5 years.
Mm-hmm. Now, we're running a little bit behind in terms of time. Now, another question with regard to the economy came from Anne Booth. She's probably already writing on her next book, so she was interested in how one actually can collect data in Burma and what statistics basically mean, if they are reliable. Has Burma become a data-producing country? But I suggest that we probably talk quickly, because we have a couple of minutes left, about Burma's international relations and international standing, because we've really just touched on this briefly in the beginning. I also would like, of course, give the Thai embassy an opportunity to call SOAS tomorrow and protest about the kind of questions we're discussing. So I...
now apparently perceiving Burma as its model for governance, given that we've had Nigeria as a model, we've had Indonesia as a model, and now Thailand has Burma as a model.
Okay, maybe we'll start with Madi.
Oh, I think you might have more knowledge than me.
I think I've already persona non grata in Thailand, so...
Exactly, fire away.
I think that... if there's a parallel to be drawn, it's with the 90s in Myanmar rather than now, right? Because the military in the 90s in Myanmar were trying to create a constitution to transfer power to a disciplined democracy, which is now what they've done. And they couldn't do it in the 90s because people were too agitated and too mobilized against the military. So the Democrats were not going to compromise. The NLD was not going to accept those terms. And many of the ethnic minority ceasefire groups were not in ceasefires, and they were boycotting the national convention. So there was a great deal of societal opposition. So the military was not able to achieve what it wanted. It sounds familiar, looking at Thailand. The military has now drafted two constitutions, both of them rejected by everybody, both of them substantively identical, because they're really struggling to square the circle of how do you restore democracy in a way that the most popular party can't return to power. Right, that is not a circle you can easily square. The difference, I guess, is that they're trying to rely much more on non-military institutions to discipline and control the next government. So I wouldn't say that they're looking to Myanmar as a model, but certainly they're trying to create a disciplined democracy. And the parallel with Thailand is people are very mobilized. They're not going to just take that lying down. So my prediction when the military staged a coup was that it would be just as much of a waste of everybody's time as the previous one. And I think my prediction has sadly been borne out. So I think in the end, they will not retreat proudly from power, as in Myanmar. I think they will have to admit defeat and hand over in a kind of cack-handed way, basically being defeated, because they have no clue as to how to resolve the social conflict at the heart of Thailand's crisis.
Sunita, are you planning on traveling to Thailand?
Only in transit. I think the question is really interesting because, you know, look at the past 20 years and look at the ups and downs that there have been in these. I mean, throughout the 90s, there were coup after coup in Thailand. You would never know if you would arrive on the day of a coup or would it be okay, you know. It wasn't only through the early 90s, certainly. But the critical part of it, I think, and the part that's really important for Myanmar to learn is that this is what happens if you have democracy in a country where you don't have democratic participation in democracy, when you don't have active citizens who understand the relationship between the taxation that they pay and the people that represent them in parliament. Where you have a government that might give you lots of fridges, cars, nice roads, the sort of the Asian argument that economic development has to come before democracy. Actually, it doesn't. It comes. Democracy doesn't necessarily have any relation to it at all. And that's why, as I said at the beginning, I really think that the critical part over the next 5 years is to ensure that this is not what happens in Myanmar, that we have active citizens who understand what it means to be living as a citizen in a democratic country and how to hold their government to account.
I think
whether or not the military is still there, that is still going to be important.
If Thailand copies from Myanmar, then one incident just happened last week, which is that one opposition party member was charged with the Communications Act because he criticized a general in his Facebook post.
That's a direct copy, isn't it?
Now, it's 7:46, so maybe we'll come to the last question, which maybe you could just briefly answer. The broader kind of geopolitical battle, of course, is between the United States and China over maybe Southeast Asia, the South China Sea, but then many people have also said that Burma at some point decided to open up because it feared that it may just become another Chinese province. How do you see this issue? Henry Devereux has a question. What opportunities and threats does the superpower of China pose for the evolving politics and economy in Myanmar? Very briefly, Sue.
Oh yeah, China has always been an important neighbor for the countries, and but in the recent past that Myanmar people have quite strong animosity towards China because of some of the projects that military government may deal with the Chinese, like Myesong Dam, the large dam project up in the north, and also the copper mine project, you know, which local people resented. But China has always been there, and the Myanmar government, or whichever the government needs to deal with China, it's an opportunity as well as challenge. China also wants to have a very, very close relationship with Myanmar because it sees the country, Myanmar, as its gateway to, you know, the South Asia and to the sea. So, but with the opening, that's why the Chinese, we saw flurry of visits from the Chinese diplomats to the NLD headquarters, you know, in the recent past. So they understand what they, from their past deeds, that only, you know, dealing only with the military government would not do well for their the country's interests. So I think there would be a closer relationship between the NLD. NLD also will diversify their dealing with the West as well as the neighboring countries.
Thank you.
I think the interesting thing about China is that, you know, it more than before, because of the amount of interest from other countries in Myanmar's very important geopolitical position, Burma is no longer the weakest partner in that relationship. Mm. And the Chinese clearly need Burma at this point quite a lot, not more than Burma needs them. And a lot of the debts that Myanmar has are, in fact, to the Chinese government. Mm. So the question of the mid-zone dam is obviously going to be a huge problem for the NLD government to sort out with China. But the development of Chaukpyu as Burma's, as China's western seaboard is probably more important than mid-zone to China, let's hope.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, sitting next to China is not going to be very comfortable for Myanmar, and never has been.
So obviously Myanmar may want a more balanced relationship, a more equidistant relationship. I think that's always been Myanmar's foreign policy, actually. It's just not been able to achieve that. Disengagement is not an option. So this links to Anne's question about statistics. It took me about 2 hours to work this out today, so I have to say these statistics. It was a lot of work, okay? China still accounts for 14% of inward foreign investment and 40% of foreign investment stock in Myanmar, and 37% of total trade as of the first half of last year. So there's a massive structural dependence on China, and it is unfortunately rather one way, although Myanmar is very important to China strategically. So China's not going away. It remains remains vital economically. It's also involved in the peace process, and it's a key actor. It has close ties to a number of the ceasefire and non-ceasefire groups, and it's going to be a big factor shaping the future. The question is, what is the quality of that engagement? Mm. China, for example, will continue to seek to build large-scale infrastructure projects in Myanmar. The One Belt, One Road agenda clearly sets the direction of travel. The question is this infrastructure going to be, as it has in the past, tied up with land grabs, forced displacement, crony capitalism, environmental devastation, and the fueling of ethnic conflict? Obviously, we would hope not. So the question is, how is this engagement going to be governed? And here there is a role, I think, for the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, which has Western states on its board to ensure that these projects are governed appropriately. There's a role for international non-governmental organizations to do that, and domestic non-governmental organizations, and, of course, the state, to ensure that the benefits of these projects are more widely shared and they are governed properly in accordance with what are, on paper, relatively good laws. And I think there is evidence from research going on at Oxford that the Chinese companies already realise that the game has changed. Yeah. And they're upping their game in terms of environmental assessment and engaging with local communities. And there are some interesting donor projects around special economic zones, for example, that are more about bottom-up, grassroots participation in setting the parameters for these kinds of external projects. So China's not going away. The question is, how do you engage with it, and how do you steer that engagement in a way that is for the good of the many rather than the few?
Final word?
Yeah, I think it's... Yes, we still have to engage with China, but civil society roles has become very important. You know, like environmentalists, civil society, they are the one who want to hold the mid-zone down. So, like, you know, this is like, you know, civil society will be working with the NLD, and there's a growing resentment of Burmese towards Chinese as exploiters. And it's like, you know, this concept will be also an increasing under the NLD government. So really, the like, you know, NLD has to balance out between the two of growing resentment of Burmese, and they are more knowledgeable, more aware of what is going on in their society, and how much and how does Chinese government exploit in Burma, and they have to continue to engage with Chinese government. So the NLD need to balance out between the two.
So we've covered 9 out of 10 questions, which I think is pretty good. The reception is one floor up, same building, and all that's left is to ask you to please join me to thank our panelists for sharing their insights.